What's up, wild people? Welcome back to my channel. If you're new, I'm Alexandria Denise. Seed packets. They can be overwhelmingly difficult to read due to producers trying to cram as much information onto this small dimension of packets as they can. Meaning, much of this information can be confusing to understand. So in this video, I want to give you the rundown on how to read a seed packet so that you can best choose the plants for your gardening needs. I got a lot of ground to cover, so let's get digging. There are so many seed companies, but we're going to be taking a look at three of the most common brands you're most likely going to run into at a store or garden center. Keep in mind, this video is not to rank or tell which companies has the better selection of seeds, but to show you examples of what you may find on different packets. Every company will have their way of how they list information, but here are some important things to note. First, let's cover the basics. Here are some things you may find on the front side of the packet. Number one, obviously and most notable, the picture, which takes up the most real estate on the packet. No brainer, this is a display of what to expect of the final product as it shows the quality and characteristics of the plant. There may be slight differences in looks due to how you care for the plant, but it should stay true to the variety inside. Next, of course, outside of the name of the seed company, there's the name of the plant. The scientific name may even be in italics somewhere nearby as experienced gardeners can further tell what they are purchasing. So like the arugula. There's a domestic kind belonging to genus Eruca vesicaria sativa and a wild variety belonging to Diplotaxis tinifolia. All of my wild varieties I grow outdoors in the summer because they're a bit more heat tolerant, but the domestic indoors in a south-facing window since they can be a little delicate for my zone in the summer. Luckily, you don't have to learn the scientific names of these plants just to choose the varieties you need, because on many packets you will find a sub-name under the name, which is the variety. You may even see it labeled cultivar, which is sometimes used interchangeably with variety, but cultivar is the correct term used amongst plant breeders and economic botany. So to keep it simple, they are pretty much the same thing. Tomato, tomato. The variety is mainly just the type of the main plant that has desired characteristics bred into it. This is one of the most important pieces to pay attention to and do research on based on your growing needs. So if you want to grow lettuce in the summer, you may want to choose a variety that's best grown in hot conditions or at least tolerate heat best, such as Super Jericho or Little Jim. Characteristics may also include plant size, space, water, and sunlight needs. Also, can it be grown in pots? Watermelon is a good example of this. Some varieties, like Sugar Baby, can be small and grown in pots, with at least 6 to 8 hours of full sun a day and an inch of water per week. Others that grow big are best in ground, needing 8+ hours of full sun a day and 1 to 2 inches of water per week. But somewhere on the packet, you should see a brief description explaining the variety and what it's capable of. Even if so, you may need to do a quick Google search describing what you need in addition to surfing YouTube to see who has experience in growing what you're trying to grow. They may tell you a different story to consider. All right, you keeping up with me? Good, because I'm on number four, and that's days to harvest or days to maturity. It's another common sight on the front of the packet and is amongst the trickiest to understand. To a degree, it does mean the typical days it takes before the plant can produce a harvest, but there are variables in if this will even happen. So, seeds and plants need certain consistent conditions in which they have to grow before reaching maturity. If a plant only grows in temperatures 60 or below, but you have had days that consistently peak 70 and beyond, then those days above 60 doesn't count towards the days to harvest because the requirements weren't met. Listen, these plants got standards. If conditions aren't met, usually one or three things will happen. The plant's growth will be stunted or it will bolt and go to seed, even die in severe cases. To make matters even more confusing, most seed companies list their days to harvest differently. Some days to harvest start on the day you stick it in the ground, aka direct sow. Others may start the day after the plant emerged from the soil and develop true leaves, which some seed companies will list this as days to germination. Then the days to maturity starts. So take this packet, for example. It's listed as 50 days to harvest, but on the back, days to germination is between 8 and 10. Yet, days to harvest remains at 50. Either the 8 to 10 days are included in the 50, or you can expect to add an additional 10 to 15 days on top of the 50, and harvest anywhere between 50 and, say, 65 days, if the growing requirements are met. This is why it's important to do some research beforehand on the variety of the plant. I personally choose plants with the shortest maturity days possible if other factors meet my needs. But wait! What about seedlings started indoors a few weeks before or transplants from nurseries? In a nutshell, days to maturity starts when you plant them in their designated spot. After so long, the roots begin to acclimate to its new conditions. Despite the inconsistency, days to harvest or days to maturity is still a good guideline. Number 5. Packeted date, sell by date, expiration date is something you may see on the front of the packet or somewhere stamped on the folds. This is simply letting you know the date in which the seeds were packaged, shipped, and when they expected to be sold by in stores. Expiration dates and sell by dates can be used interchangeably, but if kept in proper conditions, seeds don't exactly expire unless it's a specific kind. Normally, dark, cool, dry places are where seeds should be stored, and they can last for years. There are ways to test to see if seeds are viable or worth planting. You can fill a cup with water, put the seeds inside, and after 24 hours, whichever ones that are floating are not good to plant. Or you could just stick them in the ground and see if they grow. You may also see a different number near these, but this is just the tracking number in case the seeds ever need to be recalled, they know where the packets were sent out. Number 6. Additional stamps of approval, such as USDA organic or non-GMO. There's a reason this is listed, and it's mainly to ease consumer fear. All seeds sold to common backyard gardeners is going to be non-GMO. This is because to grow GMO seeds, additional chemicals are needed. Surely Bayer Monsanto would love to sell their GMO products to small backyard gardeners, but there's no way they can regulate them, unlike commercial farmers locked in contracts. There's no guaranteed profits in it for them, so they won't waste resources. Unless your crop cross-pollinates with a GMO crop, it's highly unlikely you'll end up with GMO plants. However, it is possible for non-GMO seeds to be non-organic, meaning the parent plant was grown with chemicals. This would be the most important label to look out for if it's a concern for you. Number 7. Hybrids or F1, meaning filial one or first children of two different varieties of plants that were crossbred for desired traits. These are not GMOs, but rather mutts of the plant world. They are healthy and can be organic, but the seeds are not worth saving because they will only revert back to the characteristics of one parent plant or develop weird ones of their own. You will have to repurchase them every year. Number 8. Open pollinated, or OP, is a natural means for plants to reproduce through wind, insects, water, even self-pollination. These are the purebred seeds that hold true to the parent plants and are worth saving after harvest to be planted year after year. Number 9. Heirloom is a term you will most likely see on the front of a packet and basically means that these seeds are produced from a traceable lineage of healthy, open-pollinated plants that, if produced the same way, develop unique flavors, colorings, high yields, etc. of their own. Think of it as the direct descendants of the first crops in existence or heirs to the throne. Okay, maybe that was a bit dramatic. They're not that special. But listen, if you come across a plant that sprouts magical wings and grants you 3 wishes, you might need to reproduce them seeds. Just saying. There isn't a magical number that determines when these seeds become heirloom, but it's usually agreed upon that after 3 generations or 50 years or more, a seed is considered a true heirloom. Heirlooms are pedestalized because everyone wants to be the one that grows that original or special plant, but not all packets will say if it's an heirloom, and not all open pollinated plants are heirlooms. If having an heirloom garden is your goal, then it's important to do some serious research on legit companies that pride themselves on being heirloom only. Number 10. Pelleted seeds are small and weirdly shaped seeds covered in organic clay-like material to make them easier to see and handle. These seeds are generally used for covering large surface areas, such as these clover seeds, used for deer food plots. Coating the seeds saves time in spacing them out rather than going through and thinning them later. Number 11. Treated means that seeds are pre-treated with fungicide to prevent disease. They are usually dyed to identify them as chemically treated. There is a better way to make your plants immune and resistant to disease. Pre-soaking seeds in compost tea is a natural way to give them an immunity boost. Some other notable no-brainers would be the weight of the seeds in the packet, which can determine the price the seeds are sold for. Now for the back side of the packet. Some information listed on the back is just an extended version of the front, but other things to note, and probably the most obvious, is the map of the U.S. printed in different colors. This is to represent the hardiness zones for which the plant is best suited for. Giving the watered-down version, the continent is divided into zones ranked from coldest to warmest of the average lowest winter temperatures for that region. This is important because plants need cold temperatures for multiple purposes, whether to break dormancy, gain chill hours to bear fruits for the following season, etc. But there's only so much cold they can endure. Remember when I talked about the variety or cultivar? Basically, this map is best paired with that. It may be hard for you to see on the packets, but if you go to the USDA's website, you will see the zone map where you can type in your zip code and it will locate your hardiness zone. From there, you can research the cultivar of the plants that's best grown in your zone. I will link where you can find your climate zone in the description below. Number 14. Sow depth tells you how deep to plant the seed. Larger seeds planted too shallow can't take proper root or get the needed nutrients. And smaller seeds planted too deep will be smothered and can't get proper sunlight. You don't have to get this perfect, but at least somewhat close. Number 15, spacing says how far apart you should plant your seeds so that they aren't competing for nutrients. Some plants are okay being buddy-buddy. Others, not so much. If you do end up planting seeds that need space, thinning tab will tell you at what stage to get rid of the weaklings and keep the ones you see potential in. There are two ways to thin: cut the seedlings above the soil line or uproot it. Most gardeners would disagree with the second because you can disturb sensitive root plants, but I personally have never had trouble and the plants still grow to their full potential, though it is a good precaution. Personally, I uproot what I can to transplant them either to a different spot or give them away as a way to spread the seed of gardening to others. 17 is the days to emerge, which just tells you when to expect the seeds to sprout after planting in proper conditions. 18. As an extra courtesy, a packet may list date seed sown, so you can account for the date you planted the seed. Keeping logs of the activity you do in your garden is critical to success. But trust me, you're not going to remember the date you planted every seed, when they sprouted, when you watered them, fertilized, etc. Even if you don't write it on the packet, put it somewhere. Video recording also helps me keep track. I promise, we're almost there. Number 19. Miscellaneous mentions of illustrations of the seedlings once they emerge and instructions giving you the rundown on when to plant and what temperatures, etc. As a bonus, most seed packets may even have an extensive care guide printed on the inside of the packet. Even if I know what I know, I still find these helpful and hope that you do too. Well, I think I got to the root of things in this video. If you think so, give it a green thumbs up so it can branch out and reach more people. What are you planning to grow? Leave a comment below or subscribe to the tribe here and on the Facebook group to share your success. Connect with me on other platforms and track down the daughter channel, True Nature's Kitchen, where I upload wild game recipes, keto, paleo, and other low-carb dishes. Until next time, dig your roots deep, grow beyond your haters' reach, and stay wild.